We, just to give you a heads up, we are at item 8, Chris's CIO report, and then we are going to jump down to item 12, our semi-annual performance reports, and go through that. And then we also have a couple closed session items. I just wanted to kind of brief the board and folks in the audience. Our goal is we're gonna try and finish by 3-ish. So again, you know, we want to balance timeliness, efficiency with good content. You know, we want to be thoughtful, but also utilize our time well. So with that in mind, Chris, CIO report, item 8. You get an A in my class.
My presentation's taking 2 hours, so I have to cut it to an hour and a half. The consultants are your employees, but I will chat with them because I realize Mike and Michael aren't here to hear that. Maybe they're here in the cafeteria, but I will tell them as well. So I chatted with Michael, but I haven't chatted with Mike. Gosh, and the teachers aren't back yet. No, well,
some
there we are.
Hey, Maggie.
Maggie's back. Maggie's here. She's the only one that matters. So, $190 billion was a new month-end high. We've been waffling between... we did hit a high of 192. We've been waffling between 192 and then 188 with the volatility of the markets. So that's not surprising.
I do want to just stop and say that's our first time closing above 190 billion, right? So I think that's, you know.
That was a nice to finally hit that number, flirting with it all year, as you can see, so crossing it. And basically, if you think about a horse race, and I don't know horse racing, but they call it the three-quarter pole, where you're three-quarters of the way around the track. Here we are, March 31. We only have 3 months left to go in this one-year race. So to give you kind of a snapshot at this point, the portfolio is up 3.4% fiscal year to date, so definitely short of the 7.5. The policy portfolio is up about 3.9, so we're trailing by 0.5%. Again, a lot of that still has to do with, keep in mind, it's hard to give you interim year numbers because private equity and real estate lags, so we won't get their numbers for a while. U.S. equity is up about 7.2%, as we were discussing earlier. Non-U.S. equity down 5.8%, so just the opposite direction. Almost all of that has to do with the U.S. dollar. So if you could hedge out the currency exposure, then you actually could potentially make some money in Japan and Europe, which, as I mentioned earlier, we've done. But if you're exposed just on a dollar basis, like our friends across the river, it's not been a very good year in that area. Real estate and private equity are up, but I don't have hard figures for those because, again, the quarter lag. And then absolute return is one asset class that would surprise you is up 6%. That has a lot to do with the increased volatility we're seeing in the equity markets. Even though the equity market is up 7%, fiscal year to date, so three quarters of the year. The absolute return strategy Stephen's looking at are also up because they're seeing that volatility in the markets and they're able to take advantage of that. So asset allocation, very close to where we are on our targets, as we've talked about, not a huge deviation. Here's the U.S. equity market fiscal year to date. So even though, again, that volatility shows up, it actually has been an uptrend. Up, as I said, around 7% calendar year. With the market going up and down 1% or 2% sometimes in a week, obviously 1 month could wipe out our gain fiscal year to date. So it'll be a tough year. I think we already said that. We thought it'd be a hard year to make it 7.5, and it's proving. So let's back up for a minute and look at the longer term view. This previous slide is only the part that's in the circle up there. You back up and look since the market low, which is March 9th of 2009, so of this six-year period, the U.S. equity market up on an average of 20% per year. That's a heck of a bull run market. So risks, very much what we have seen before. I think the big thing that we've talked about is the dispersion of central bank returns. We're seeing some central banks tighten. We're seeing a lot of central banks, particularly the UK and the US, consider easing, or probably tightening. The rest of the world's easing. I've lowered the GDP forecast. We were thinking it'll grow at 3%. It looks like it's going to grow at 2% like it did last year. And then the other thing I would note is if you look at my charts, I highlighted several of the PCA numbers. So INV 119, three of the pricing measures are at unfavorable prices. And then when it comes to the lower chart, the extreme risk measures, both inflation's at an all-time low and interest rate risk at an all-time high. I think we've been saying for over a year that interest rate risk could be at an all-time high, and that just continues. But just keep your eyes on those. As we discussed, real estate private equity are a pretty rich pricing right now, kind of priced to perfection, so it's hard to buy. And we would say that roughly the same about the U.S. equity market. So it is tough to figure out where to put any cash. We are going into a very heavy negative cash period for us. It starts in May because contributions dry up for the summer. So we'll be draining our cash anyway. And we forecast that out a year in advance. But with that, any questions?
One comment I'll make is I will comment, I don't know if board members are aware, but Chris and his team do quarterly videos, and I think they're incredibly well done, and especially they're short. They're 3 to 4 minutes because all of our, you know, it's you got a little bit amount of time, but I do commend the investment committee members to check out the videos because I think it's a really nice interview style that you have with the different directors, and it does really highlight items in the board book as well as just kind of gives us an overarching view of the world. So I think those are highly informative. And then the quarterly and annual investment reports, which I think sometimes people lose sight of where those are, but they're on our board book and you can check those out.
Importantly, they are all on the .com. There are a whole set of public quarterly reports that are very similar to yours that are available to the public, and they are on the .com. And we're looking at ways to record videos for the public that don't want to read through the book so they can see through it too. So it works. Yeah. It's working well.
That's great. Alan, Mika, do you guys have any other thoughts from Chris's report, comments, contrasting views? Okay, great. All right, seeing nobody from the investment committee questions, we'll move on. Thank you, Chris. So let's go ahead and move to item 12, which is our general consultant, Alan Emkin, semi-annual performance report.
Okay. Madam Chair, members, Alan Emkin, PCA, for the period ending 12/31/14. I'll be quick. I'll refer you to page INV89. One thing that it's really sort of important to keep in mind that the portfolio had a positive return for that six-month period, but it ended with less money than it started with, and that's because of negative cash flow. And that's one of those things that's very important to keep in mind as we go through asset allocation. It's a drag on your ability to reach financial objectives when you have negative cash flow because money's not compounding. On that page, there are comparisons versus your benchmark and versus your peers. Versus your peers, you beat them in every single period. Versus your benchmark, you trailed in every single period. And a large part of that trailing is the result of an issue we've discussed in the past, which is benchmark misspecification for private equity. We've gone through a period, which Chris just explains, extraordinary public equity performance. When you have a public equity benchmark plus a premium, you're not going to do well. But what's important to keep in mind, if you look at longer periods in time, 10 years, private equity, in fact, almost doubles the performance of your public equity. And it did exactly what you would hope it to do. And your previous discussions on changing the benchmark and how it's measured, in many ways, were prescient. Please go to 110. And just like Chris says, you're pretty much close to all of your targets, which will drive performance. Overweight public equity, underweight private equity. That's consistent with all the previous discussions. There's not much you can do about that. Turn the page to 111. And a couple of takeaways. Basically, the U.S. equities are basically flat net of fees. The non-U.S., there's modest value added, but value added. Fixed income did well over all periods. In the fixed income market, you just had to make one good decision in the previous decade. You just had to take credit risk. And if you just took credit risk and didn't hold government bonds, you'd beat the benchmark on a consistent basis. And that's what most active fixed income managers do. They underweight credit. To their great credit, real estate has come back after the big losses, and Michael Lynn will get into that in some detail, but they really came back strong. And the long-term performance for private equity, even though it doesn't look good in the near term, long-term, it's outstanding and accomplishing what you would have hoped. Something I rarely talk about, but I'm going to do it because when you give good news occasionally, you should. On INV 113, it shows your three largest active managers. And in domestic equity, and each one of those has beat their benchmark over almost every period. And so as much as I love indexation, at least those managers have added value over those periods. And it's even more true for your international equity managers on 115, where those are the largest managers, and they've done an excellent job. So credit to your equity, public equity staff there. Almost done. The portfolio is performed as expected. No big surprises. It's driven by what happens in the markets because the active management at the end is only marginally important. It's what happens to the stock and bond market that's really important. The markets are all fully priced in our opinion. And as we discuss in the next meeting, capital markets assumptions, you're going to see that, at least for PCA, the capital market assumptions are mooted at best. Happy to answer any questions.
Any questions from the committee? Seeing none. Oh, go ahead, Chris.
Just real short, not so much a question as two statements. First on, INV 85 and 86. That was intended to be back-to-back, so printing threw us off there. But the idea is to give you a one-page, double-sided summary of a performance you can take with you and use if you have questions from stakeholders. The other takeaway is I attended a long-term investing conference hosted by the Canadian Public Pension Plan, McKinsey, and BlackRock. And one of the key takeaways was that quarterly performance is irrelevant, which thankfully we don't look at, but I will tell you other peers, maybe even in this town, look at. But that even semi-annual performance is probably too short-term. And as I think Alan highlighted, the six-month return is noise, and even the one-year return is not really terribly meaningful for us, even a calendar year return. And the thing I will throw out there that I think we have to start thinking about, and we'll talk with communications, is could we really just start reporting out and focusing on a rolling three-year return? Because obviously that's your actuarial period. That's the one that really matters, is what's the three-year return? You need to monitor the fund more closely because of trustees, but it's also a message we send to the public, which is, you know, we don't look at the 1 year. You hear me say that's the pace per mile in a marathon. At least a three-year number is... not even that's long-term when you have a 30-year horizon, but to try and start stretching the envelope a bit and pushing this out.
Chris, are you asking us as an investment committee if we
I'm
can
just
start
setting,
doing that?
Planting that a flag to think about that. We'll okay. work with communications, and, okay. and I think that's something we can noodle on for the future is right. how could you adjust these reports to be looking longer term? We want to get you the data, but it's also a matter of what do we emphasize out to the public
right.
and where do we show our focus is. 1 year time periods, or is it really on rolling 3 year time periods?
And I can speak from experience that when I go around and speak to teachers, they do tend to kind of glom on to the number from last year. And I always communicate, we're long-term investors. We have to look at the big picture. So I think we have to contextualize that data for folks, for our members to kind of understand who we are as long-term investors. So point well taken. Thank you. All right. Thank you, Alan. We're good. Michaelin, come on up. Real estate semiannual report. Need a clicker? You can stay up there, Mika, the whole time for all the. No, that's okay. You're good. You're very thoughtful, but you can hang out.
Even though I was trying to block the door, I really I just want to point out that nobody came to my side of the room, and they were all over. I don't know what those guys were doing over there.
I really appreciated the hard work.
They stayed away from my side, so clearly, the mother in me. Mike Lynn McGee with the Townsend Group, working with your September 30th numbers. I'm going to point you first to INV 191-4. I'm not sure where we're getting the dashes from, but that's new. And if I can... this is the funding status for your real estate portfolio. Just pointing out that as we've discussed with you previously, you are underfunded on a target basis, your target of 13%. But you are well within the range of your real estate. That current funding really reflects the fact that we have been very cautious, your staff has been very cautious in investing, focusing mostly on core, good liquidity and control investments, and minimal opportunistic and value opportunities where they saw both strong management track records as well as an opportunity to enhance the portfolio's returns. Oops, didn't want to go. And I apologize if you're looking at this on hard copy, because we just had some, you know, really expensive expert come in and do, you know, all the, like, psychographically correct colors. They don't print worth anything. So I'll work on trying to get it so that it's a little more visible, but these are the colors we're supposed to use. This chart shows the performance, and I, as Chris indicated, that three-year number is a good solid number. However, I would suggest to you that with real estate, when we're looking at full market cycles, you're really looking more at least a five-year cycle and more likely around a 10-year. And so for real estate, the longer-term numbers are not as good as we would like them to be, but the near-term numbers are showing that we've improved that performance. And most importantly, this chart shows the post-correction time-weighted return. So these are the investments that your staff has made since the market correction, and you can see that your investment selection has improved. You're still well outperforming the broader market, and these are risk-adjusted broader market benchmarks for you. And so that's showing great concern and care for their investment selection, as well as good results in this period of time. And that is not very well assisted by recovery in those earlier vintage years. Some of your earlier vintage year funds, they've done okay, but they haven't hit the objectives that we would like them to have hit overall. So this is really very heavily weighted towards those new investments being well above market in their top tier, top quartile selections. This is a compliance check, and you will see that across the board, your program is in compliance with all of the strategic requirements. Your core is within the range of 40 to 65%. Same with value and high return. All of your loan-to-values are within the ranges that they are expected to be. They are not quite at the targets that we have for the portfolio, but we are within range. The next page shows where you are relative to the targets, and I think I'll remind you that we planned on getting you here sometime around 2017, and as we've said before, you're going to be there. As a matter of fact, you're there by the end of the first quarter of this year. Certainly by the end of June. So you have successfully rebalanced the portfolio to a more conservative position and increased your returns. So that's a great performance report to be able to present. I am not going to do the market overview for the sake of time, But I do want to highlight for you just some of the points that I was trying to make in my comments. We are concerned about where we are in the marketplace. I'm not a basketball fan or a baseball fan. I like football. We definitely are in the fourth quarter of this market recovery. The difference and the difficulty in projecting any kind of a correction is that supply and demand, as well as economic recovery, seem to be supporting the pricing that we continue to see. So even with conservative estimates on growth of rents, growth of occupancy, and the supply that's coming online, market by market, you can really see that there continues to be opportunities for investment, and that despite rich pricing, a 5 to 6% return on a real estate investment is a better income return than you can get in most portions of your portfolio. And so investors are continuing to invest. Encouraging for me is the fact that your staff continues to question whether the market still will take its capital. And that's a very encouraging sign, because they're really, really very focused on reducing that risk, taking as little as possible, and guarantees the returns that can be generated for the asset class. And that's all I had.
Great. Any questions for Mike Lynn from the committee? Great. Thank you, Mike Lynn.
Thank you.
And Mike Moy, private equity. And I asked Mike in his semiannual report, there's been a lot of conversations around private equity, and you know, I think we've had a lot of talk around the opaqueness, and they've been in the news a lot. So if you wouldn't mind just spending a couple minutes briefing us, Mike, on how you see the world in private equity right now, that would be great.
Okay, I will. The comments on performance, I think, will be. Have been pretty well outlined in the highlight section. Everyone's talked about the benchmark mismatch, which we made a change July 1 of 2014. You won't see that flowing through the benchmark comparisons until in the future.
When will we see that, the changes that we made?
Well,
in the benchmark,
it starts July 1, 2014.
Okay.
So, and this is as of September 30. So effectively, you have 90 days in the numbers here, and it's 90 days for each of the time periods. And you'll go out 180 days, it'll be 207. It's just going to take a long time for it to work through the numbers. So you're going to have mismatch going forward for a while. I think the most interesting thing that's been happening for the past, I'll say, 12 months, is the SEC investigation, where they did examinations of about 150 private equity funds and claimed that they discovered a 50% rate of either miscalculations or other items that the rate of discovery was extremely high, half of the group. And since then, there's been a variety of, let's call it, reported items that have indicated a couple of things. Several managers have announced that they have gone in and recalculated the different numbers that were being reported out to LPs. And in those recalculations, they've actually refunded money to some clients. The observation that's been made by the SEC and others is that there has been much more movement towards transparency by the LPs, but it's hard to quantify that. It's more anecdotal. And then the most recent event was a panel that was conducted at Stanford University, which PERS and STERS had representatives at that. And the reporters were at it from Naked Capitalism. And they interpreted the comments that were made by the SEC representatives that they were in the tank for private equity GPs. And when I looked at the tape, because I looked at the full tape, if you looked at like the last 3 minutes of the tape, you could come away with that conclusion. But if you looked at it for like 6 minutes, the last 6 minutes, you came to a different conclusion. It was an hour and 10-minute panel. The last questioner appeared to be a graduate student. And in the response that was being given by the panelists, the SEC person spoke up and basically indicated that he thought the private equity asset class was one of the best things out there. It makes a lot of money for its investors. The people who are practicing it make a lot of money also. And he said, just don't mess it up. And the questioner then said, well, you know, and excuse me, the SEC person went on to say that he had been telling his son that the private equity asset class would be a good place to, you know, become employed at some point in time. And the questioner at that point in time made the observation, you know, I'll hire your son. And the audience laughed extensively. And I viewed that to me as sort of a throwaway. But the author of the articles in Naked Capitalism viewed that as being in the tank. So I just wanted to communicate that to you because to me it's just two people looking at the same set of facts and coming to different conclusions. But where it's ultimately going to go, I think it's ultimately going to go towards more transparency. I've taken some steps to try and get the different groups, ILPA, the Institutional Limited Partners Association, and CII, to become the focal point for putting together a coalition of LPs who would be involved in trying to move certain things along, because effectively I discovered that there's no real combined institutional effort to try and get things to happen. It's much more on an individual basis. And from the perspective of, let's call it accomplishing an objective, the more people you have behind it, the better. But I've discovered that for CII, they really don't have a high level of interest because they're so wrapped up in governance. And the ILPA group, although they claim to be representing the limited partners, they really haven't been doing very much in terms of once they put together the templates that are being used, they have not been effective in terms of trying to influence general partners in terms of policy and transparency. So I think we're going to see differences, but it's just going to take a while.
Okay. So going back to your discussion of this event at Stanford, so the SEC person said, it's been a great asset class. Don't screw it up.
And don't mess it up.
Don't mess it up. Don't mess it up. So your telling of the story seems to suggest that you think that pressuring the SEC will mess it up. I mean, I'm not sure I understand what the point here is. I mean,
no, his observation was sort of directed at the GPs who are in the audience. Basically, this is the SEC talking. He's saying don't mess it up in terms of behaviorally doing things that we're going
to. He wasn't talking to this person who was questioning.
That person asked the question, and as the SEC was given this response, the audience was made up of GPs and students, and he's basically telling the GPs, don't mess it up. He wasn't talking to himself. Because he was the SEC,
right? But I wasn't sure about the naked capitalism issue. I mean, I'm trying to figure out what the point is about the criticism of the SEC by naked capitalism. Because the naked capitalism, there's a lot of debate as to whether the SEC is pushing hard enough, and there's a lot of debate as to how to get more pressure on this issue, and so is your suggestion that you think the SEC is doing everything they can and that criticism of the SEC is wrong, or is there more that, you know, in other words, is more pressure on the SEC something that those who want to see some changes should be exerting?
I think the answer to your question simply is yes. They should be putting more pressure on the SEC. I happen to believe there's a resource constraint that is preventing them from being able to do that, primarily because they've announced that they're going to be going after the hedge fund industry. And my guess, and I haven't talked to anybody there, my guess is that that's going to take resources away from looking at private equity.
Do you think that people who are pushing on the SEC to do more are being counterproductive, like the naked capitalism?
Absolutely not.
Okay, so I'm trying to figure out what the point was about the naked capitalism discussion that you want us to understand.
Well, it was being reported that the SEC was in the pockets of the GPs, and I don't think that's the case.
Maybe let me follow. Can okay. I follow up on that? Because you finished your remarks saying that you think there is going to be a movement towards more transparency in private equity. And I'm just trying to square that with at least my experience in, I have a lot of respect for the SEC. I've met folks that work with the SEC, but I've heard the same challenges around resources and heard the same thing around allocation of resources to hedge funds and looking at that. So how, I guess my question is how do you see that transparency? How do you see more transparency in that private equity world when the SEC is probably going to be distracted? Where is that going to come from, that pressure to be more transparent?
Well, I'm promoting the idea that the transparency will escalate if the LPs assert their rights collectively under the Delaware law, which is where most of the partnerships are domiciled. They have the right to inspect the books of the partnership, and some limited partnership agreements have granted to the limited partners the ability to request through the advisory committee the appointment of an external auditor to go in and do compliance work. And I think that effectively will augment what the SEC is doing. It's being done in some cases, but not very many. Nobody wants to do it individually. So if you get it into a limited partnership agreement, it would be a collective effort, and it would be paid for by the fund or by the investors. And it would effectively do what the SEC has been doing.
Thanks, Mike. Is there anything else you wanted to include in your semi-annual report, Mike?
Or I'm sorry?
Is there anything else you wanted to include
in
your semi?
No, that's all I really had.
Any other questions from the investment committee? Hang on, let me just see. Okay, Alan?
Just on that issue, it's just important to keep in mind, it's not as though the private equity industry loves to have more transparency and loves to have people looking at them. It's my understanding that they have a major effort in Congress to have Congress try to address funding issues with the SEC or exclude private equity completely from the governance and oversight. And so it's important to keep that in mind.
I should just clarify what my line of questioning was, because it seems to me that the SEC is a very important part of our effort, is to pressure the SEC. And so while I respect what the SEC is doing, I don't think our focus should be defending the SEC. I think our focus should be pushing the SEC. And that doesn't mean we have to go so far as to say, you know, they're in the pocket of private equity. But I also don't think it's our job to defend them against their critics. I think it's our job to push them. So
the one thing I was going to add was that there was a proposal that passed the House and went to the Senate in the first quarter that effectively would allow or grant exemption from the broker-dealer registration to general partnerships with more than $150 million in assets. And there was no real concerted effort by the limited partners to notify the Senate. The CII actually went out and canvassed their membership to get input on that. which to me was a sort of a failure on the part of lobbyists who are kind of watching what's going on and representing what the limited partners would have an interest in, because exemption from SEC would exempt them from those kinds of exams, and that to me made no sense.
Joy.
And I just, given that both Mike and Alan commented about some of this activity happening in Washington, whether it's legislation or other kind of policy initiatives, would it be appropriate to have our John Stanton,
mm-hmm.
just sort of make sure to keep us abreast of that, and if there
sure.
are, would be appropriate opportunities for us to weigh in or just know what the policy discussion is like in Washington?
Mm-hmm. Lamont, you have that as a information request? Thank you. Thanks, Joy. Good input. Great. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
All right. We've got Anne Sheehan. Corporate governance policy revision and executive comp guidelines. And Aisha. Hi, Aisha. I've been busy. I've been following your career here.
Good afternoon. Anne Sheehan, Director of Corporate Governance. I'm joined by Aisha Mastagni. This is item 15, and it is part two of the revisions of our corporate governance principles, our voting principles. And what this is, we've got three different things. One is executive compensation. Previously, we had exec comp guidelines that were as an appendix to our voting guidelines. So what we have done is incorporated them directly into the voting guidelines. We have updated them a little bit, and after I briefly go over a summary, I'll have Aisha touch on a few of the things, because with the advent of say on pay and more activity on executive compensation, there are a few things that we put in here just to be more explicit about what our preferred policy is on executive compensation as we look at CDNAs of companies and vote the proxies. The other part of this is new language under our board diversity section in response to the very thoughtful letter from the state treasurer of adding sexual orientation identification to board diversity. We had always included that, but we think it's a very good suggestion from the treasurer to make it more explicit, so when we chat with companies about what we look for in diversity, that is included. And then finally, we had a typo last time about how many boards people can sit on. It's four other boards. I think it came out five, but it really is the boards they're sitting on and then four other outside boards. And that's the standard that we hold directors to when we talk about overboarding of boards of directors, as we call it. So let me have Aisha touch a little bit on some of the specifics of the comp briefly, understanding I know we're pressed on time, and then we'll take any questions. The only other thing I would say, a couple other things, while it's an information item, we'd love it if you'd approve it, because we're starting to vote proxies, so we'll vote the policy, our old policy anyway, but so it's just, it's helpful in that regard. And then the other thing I want to congratulate Aisha, because I think, as you all know, she just got elected to the board of the Council of Institutional Investors. So we are very excited. Yeah, very happy about that. One other brief thing, there's something that we'll give you enclosed in terms of some of the engagement plan that we have for this year. But the other thing I wanted to share with you is that we signed on to a petition that nine other funds have filed at the SEC. Seeking greater disclosure on the composition of boards and directors, including the diversity of the boards. You know, how many females, the ethnicity of some of the board members. It's hard sometimes for us when names can be, you know, either male or female. We don't always know the ethnic diversity of the boards. So a number of funds have petitioned the SEC as they're looking at their, and the SEC is currently doing a disclosure project in the Corporation Finance Division. So we've asked them if they could make it a little more explicit. So you may see some press coverage around that, but there were a number of funds led by Janet Cowell, who's the treasurer of North Carolina, and we signed on to that. So let me turn it over to Aisha quick.
Sure. Quickly make a comment, and then Aisha, you can.
Unfortunately, the treasurer couldn't be here today, but he just wanted me to let you know that he appreciates the inclusion of the language that he sent in the letter in the policy.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Great, Aisha.
Good afternoon.
Hi.
So I'm just going to quickly go over sort of at a high level. This agenda item has a lot of attachments, but I think probably the best way to look at it is on INV 269, because you can see sort of the color-coded version. And we organized this section so it starts at the very high level to asking for the company's philosophy. It goes into the elements of the plan, incentive metrics, and then it gets more granular into the structure of the plan itself. And then the last section is on accountability, what we expect from the compensation committees when they're sort of backward looking at these types of plans. The sections that are new, one, for whatever reason, we never really talked about the salary portion of an executive's compensation, so that's new. The other piece is on hedging and pledging and our outlook on that, and there's actually a rule, speaking again of the SEC, they're seeking comments right now on hedging and pledging rules, so we'll be commenting on that. And lastly was on the director equity ownership policy. So most of this was just a reshuffling, but I think it's organized well now. It's helpful for companies when we're talking to them about compensation, and also helpful for us when we're voting plans.
And the just in case a couple of the members are not aware in terms of when we talk about hedging and pledging, it's one of board of directors. One, we want members of boards of directors to have skin in the game and to own equity in the companies where they're sitting on the boards. But what we don't want them to do is to hedge their exposure, because if the stock, we want them to be subjected to the performance of the stock, just like, right. So if they hedge out their exposure to that. And then also in terms of the pledging of the stock, because if there were, and there was a famous case at Chesapeake Energy where the CEO pledged his stock and there was a margin call and, you know, the company had to loan him the money to cover the margin call. We don't think that is a good governance practice, either hedging or pledging by directors. So that's why we wanted to make it explicit in our executive compensation policies.
Questions?
Excellent. Are there any questions from the committee? As Anne mentioned, this is coming to us as an information item, but we can go ahead and approve it. Is there any issue with us approving this as an action item today? I'd entertain a motion.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? It is approved. Thank you.
Good job.
Thanks so much. Item 16 is the work plan discussion. Chris?
Yeah, this is your opportunity, INV 320. To basically set the ballot. In June, you're going to vote on these. We'll give you 7 points, and you can allocate your 7 points all to one item or to 1 point to 7 items. But this is a chance for you to set what this is on here. The initial draft list that's on 320 came out of things that I've heard you say or from the prior ballots we've had in past years. One of the things I know, Paul's here, somebody had mentioned minimizing costs or reviewing the costs of investments. We've also talked in the past about commodities and some of those things, but we're going to take whatever you would like to see here. So the issue is the investment committee will vote in June on what the priorities are. We'll ask the two consultants to give you recommendations. To tease you, you ignored those last year, but that's okay. Just teasing. They get used to it. They've gotten it over it. I haven't, but they have. But you'll vote in June. We'll quickly tabulate it and let you know what it is. But what happens is, I know you're also the retirement board, but it comes back in July to the retirement board, with Sharon as chair presenting it of, here's what the investment committee wants on their work plan for next year, which the board technically approves as yourselves. So your chance to give input. This is your work plan on 319. I tried to give you a bit of a graphic of kind of how we see the world as your staff of, you know, what are the big picture priorities, then what are the things you're having us do within that side of that, and then obviously the projects you're having us do for you as the investment committee. The big one next year obviously will be the asset allocation policy. We should finish that, I would imagine, in September. There may be a little tail into November, but basically we'll finish it in September. that would leave you November, February, April, June of next year to plan out other projects. So I'm saying one big one or two small ones, unless you want to go past 5 o'clock every night. So
we're going to have a whole day on Wednesdays, Chris, starting in July. So okay. So are you looking, is this just an information item?
It's information, but we're looking for you to give us ideas of, you know what, I'll pick on Dana's favorite, drop number 6 and add something or add 7 more items, whatever you want. Dana, just so you know, always votes for one vote for timber, studying timber. I have something to do with where she lives. I don't know.
Chris, are you looking for additions, or are you looking for comments on the 6 that are on the page right now?
Both. Either or.
Well, I like number 1 considerably. I think it would be good for us to, over a period of time, to really flush out what our individual and collective beliefs are. I mean, and I think it would go nicely with asset allocation, because the belief should help drive how we come out with asset allocation. And it's an exercise I don't recall us ever formally going through this process. And I've heard of other funds that have gone through the process, and I've only heard positive experiences that people have gone through. I think if we decide to do that, I think the question is who does it, when we do it, and what's the cost of doing it. So I'm going to weigh heavily in on fleshing out those investment beliefs for us individually and then collectively. Because I think some of the discussions we have at our meetings and the areas of agreement and areas of difference agreement are simply around beliefs that we have.
Paul?
I'm sorry, I'm just not that familiar with what the concept is of investment beliefs. Which investment theory you believe in? Is it personal beliefs about social objectives with investments? What is it?
So the exercise that I have experience with, and it's the only experience I have with it directly, was with Sharon in December when we went to Rotman, and they put the 30 of us from trustees from around the world in different groups. And it was around this whole concept of investment beliefs. And the professor provided us with about 150 different specific beliefs around investment, active versus passive, fees matter, concentrated portfolios in private equity are better than multiple managers. There's a free lunch. I mean, there was a list, about 150. And then the groups, what we had to do within those groups, we were charged with coming back with 5 to 7 beliefs from the group. So you had about 7 different people from 7 different backgrounds, 7 different experiences, and we were guided by the 150 or so beliefs that the professor provided for us. And then we had to flush out of those beliefs what we thought were going to drive returns. And through that exercise, it helped frame in a very concentrated couple of hours, really kind of what the individual groups believed about how investments work. So that's the short of it, Paul. I had no experience of it before. I've heard other funds do it, but that was the one example. And then having the professor provide for us, what do we mean by investment beliefs when they broke them down? Diversity matters. Diversification matters. International equities are going to outperform U.S. equities over the period of time. It was just a real long list.
Okay.
And what he said he got where he gathered that information, it wasn't all of his. He went to different institutional investor websites and took their beliefs and put them in together and said, go at it. We think it's important for the trustees to flush out and senior staff to flush out what we believe individually and collectively. And the purpose of that was by just verbalizing and going through the exercise, it helps frame where we're coming from and potentially could drive us to where we want to go.
So is it a process of just people expressing their beliefs? Or, I mean, a lot of this is kind of is kind of, if you will, sort of evidence based. I mean, there's a lot of investment theory and a lot of investment theory that says, you know, there's a right answer to these things and a wrong answer, not to all of them, but to some of them. You know, that generally people who have had diversified portfolios over a long period of time have done better than people who haven't. So what I'm trying to understand is to some degree I think it's beliefs, but it's to some degree I think it's education. So I would wonder how much of an education component goes into it before we have our statement of beliefs.
I think there should be some education. Okay. Because the baseline is different for different people.
Right.
And absolutely, because the beliefs ultimately should be driven by data.
Yeah.
Facts. And facts.
Okay, so it's a combination.
It's a combination of
education and then what we each take away from that education.
Right.
Great, thank you.
But
sure.
Can I just add one
yeah,
thing?
Go ahead.
Though?
Yeah,
because
absolutely.
The one caveat I would give is I think it's clear from anyone watching us that our beliefs come out when we have conversations about asset allocation or different items. And I think the investment belief exercise we went through, what was helpful is, you know, our beliefs are sort of implicit as we're talking as a board, the 10 of us. But the investment belief exercise allows all those sort of dynamics to have a conversation and then agree as a body to say, okay, what are the 5 or 6 or whatever, however many beliefs we can sort of agree on so that as we move forward and have conversations around asset allocation, those beliefs are sort of speaking from kind of a common language, if that makes sense. That seemed to be the value that I saw in it. So
the other place I think we had some exposure was we've heard CIOs and chief executives also speak about funds doing this around different types of beliefs around risk and potential risks that could be disruptive to any portfolio, and specifically around ESG issues. And it seems to be a common theme. I don't see there's a lot of well, it would take a commitment of time and resources to do this, but I think we could be enriched as a board by going through the process if it's done properly by the right person that guides us through it and it's planned out properly.
I'm going to get to Terry.
excuse me. Yes, CalPERS went through that exercise, came up with 10 investment beliefs, I believe is the number, and then they also did it for pension beliefs. But instead of 3 to 4 hours, it took about 9 to 12 months because it was, you know, a process trying to narrow that down and make sure they got it right. But I think it's been helpful, I think, to the organization to have that framework, that foundation. It's, I think, been very useful for them over the last year.
Thanks,
Terry. Alan.
Having been part of the CalPERS experience and having done it for Oregon and for Virginia and for the UAW, what it allows you to do is bring to the surface where people might have different opinions and address that in a format where it can be resolved so you don't have ongoing issues that don't have some form of collective decision. And it's intended to bring to the fore where you, in fact, don't agree. Active-passive is the classic. Looking at risk, well, one of the risks is funding risk. How do you look at funding risk? And how do you look at funding risk relative to investment risk? And the investment belief process literally allows not only the board, but it includes the staff. Because you find out that the staff may not have the same beliefs that you do. And at the very least, you should know about that. And it creates an opportunity for there to be a dialogue. And in all three of those, it included interviews with each one of the individual board members, interviews with the staff, multiple iterations where people, where you agree and where you disagree. And you find out on 80% of the issues, people agree, 90% of the issues. I call those a low-hanging fruit. It's the 10% where there's a disagreement that you really get into something that's important.
Other input from? So I think my only suggestion, Chris, I'll just kind of throw these out and you guys can, but like the $1 trillion clean investment, I don't know if that came up from years ago. I haven't heard people talking about that, at least on the board, so I didn't know if that was some...
It's something we signed last year, so it's a pledge we've made out there in public, but we haven't worked on it.
I guess I just want to say that in open session. I guess I'm just trying to, figure out how to focus so that when we come to this in June, we can...
From experience, I would tell you, like anything, a shorter set of options.
I just think less is better. My personal, but certainly if other people have different opinions.
Yeah, you've all been through that experience where your spouse says, "I'm hungry," and then you say, "Italian, no; Mexican, no." And I would tell you, in the past, we came to you with a list of 10 options, and we got 10 first place votes.
Yeah, I don't want that.
So fewer is always better. It helps you concentrate.
Yes.
Last year, the top two absolutely popped off the scale. There was no question. That's the point of the 7-point scale. It kind of costs you to decide, I like everything, but here's what I really like.
Yeah.
So it's up to you how you want to do this. It's your agenda. You have to set the table. We follow your lead.
So I actually see how certainly number three, the review of global equity weighing and home country bias, I could see how that could get flushed out through the beliefs exercise. Clearly not as in-depth if we just focused in on that, but that's going to get flushed out through beliefs. Sustainable investment themes, that's going to get flushed out through beliefs on some level. It should get touched and looked at. The evaluation, number six, of agriculture and timber investments, that's going to get flushed out in beliefs. And I think the evaluation of risk mitigation strategies, I think that will get flushed out in beliefs. So I think five out of those six would actually fall under some concept of beliefs. So I'm pushing for choice number one.
Do you want me to bring a ballot back in June, or are you voting?
No, I'm just... Tom's not here, so we're voting in June. I just want to make that clear.
We're
having a conversation right now.
So before Harry started talking, I thought I understood what the investment beliefs exercise was. I have a hard time seeing how evaluation of risk mitigation strategies is beliefs. I think risk mitigation strategies is our investment experts coming in with the data, which I think is going to be part of our asset allocation study of what are some risk mitigation strategies. I don't have beliefs about risk mitigation strategies, except I'd like to see some.
You know there's risk, and you want to mitigate them.
But I have no idea, because I look to these guys who are a lot smarter and knowledgeable than me. It's not a matter of belief. It's a matter of, so I can see how some of these things are beliefs, but it seems to me that a lot of these things are not beliefs. They are relying on our experts to help us understand what our options are. And then if they give us a risk mitigation strategy, then we can say we want a risk mitigation strategy, or we don't want a risk mitigation strategy because we want to take on a lot of risk. So I think there's a distinction, and that's where I want to make that distinction between the beliefs and I don't know if that makes sense.
Can I just jump in too?
So, Paul, I don't disagree with you, okay, but I do believe that the whole, our appetite for risks individually, your appetite for risk and my appetite for risk are going to be very different. That will be flushed out through the through the process of belief. So I think we may be saying this, we may be saying the same thing.
I think we don't need to go into risk mitigation strategies because I think we're going to be doing that as part of the asset allocation study.
That was going to be, I'll just speak and then Alan, you go.
We're
going to vote in June. But yeah, I think my suggestion is, and I think we talked about this on the phone the other day with the investment, with Chris and Alan and Paul and I, with the investment prepping for this meeting, that risk mitigation strategies I do see as part of our asset allocation study, and I think those strategies, I will hope, Stephen, Mika, Alan, PCA folks, that we'll have some of those conversations as we go through the asset allocation study. So I see it kind of happening there. And I think the other pieces, Harry, I agree, that could be part of our investment beliefs conversation. So, but I guess I also did want to kind of throw out, you know, Paul's comment about the, I don't know how you want to say, costs and fees, you know, potentially.
Well, I think we all agree that if there's a costless way to reduce risk, or there's a riskless, more to the point, there's a riskless way to enhance returns, we want to take it. And that's one way to define reducing expenses, is it's a riskless way to enhance returns. So I really think that when we're trying to, you know, earn 7.5% and we have 41 basis points of expenses, that's a big number. And so, you know, it seems to me that's a really important focus long term, is how do we reduce expenses. Now maybe Harry would say, well, that's an opinion, that's a belief as to whether it's important to reduce expenses.
I think we know what would have to happen for us to reduce the fees of managing this portfolio.
I
do.
Okay.
We'd have to move more passively. We'd have to be more index. We'd have to get it out of active management. We'd have to reduce our exposure to private equity. And we have to reduce our exposure to real estate. That's where the fees are driven. That's what we would have to do, I think.
Well, that's one way.
So I think we would have the belief whether or not we believe we should be investing as much as we have been in private equity.
Right. That gets back to Harry's comment about investment.
No.
Well, let me ask our consultant to chime in.
I disagree because I think it part of it has to do with how important it is to focus on trying to get the reduction in private. I mean, I think we all agree. We're hearing generally private equity has been a very important driver,
but
if we can enhance our returns from private equity by 25 basis points by reducing the expenses of private equity by 25 basis points, that's a good thing.
I agree.
And so, you know, are there ways to do that?
But do we have to spend a year studying?
I don't know. Maybe not.
Are you guys getting a head start on our investment belief conversation?
Each year we get a report on the cost of managing the fund. Each year we reported that we're making progress in reducing the cost. Each year we say we'd really like to drive the cost down further. And each year we hear being told to us that this fund is run relatively at a low cost to other large institutional investors. And we get that from an independent view.
Well, maybe it doesn't have to be the focus of the study. It still needs to be a focus of our investment.
We agree. Right. We agree.
Great.
That we agree on.
We agree on that. Mr. Emkin.
I'm not sure I'm going to shed any light on it. It's your mic.
Everyone's study always says it's important to control costs. So everyone who's done investment beliefs is focused on cost, because under any circumstance, reducing cost is a good thing. And so that's a given. How you choose to do it, that's an implementation issue, which isn't an investment belief. It's totally different. And the key is investment beliefs tend to be macro, big picture, not implementation issues. Those are dealt with separately. It's to deal with the big policies that govern what you believe should happen in the investment portfolio relative to risk and return.
So I think we're getting, I'm listening to this conversation, I think we're getting tied up around the word beliefs, which I think is a kind of a strange word. I mean, you ask me what I believe. I believe we should make a whole lot of money at very little risk, right? Now, that's not a very helpful belief in this context, but I firmly believe it. And what I hear the conversation evolving into is that there are some kinds of generic issues that maybe we should talk about as issues and see what kind of consensus we have among the board. I'm also not totally convinced that having a board consensus around them is necessarily a good thing, right? There's much to be said for having a divergence of, for example,
I think we have a problem with that.
Yeah, tolerance around risk, right? And or any of these other subjects. So, but to have the conversation around the question of to what extent do you want to, let's use the one you've been talking about, which I, you know, to what extent do we want to drive down the cost of investing? And is that worth the potential of trading it off with something else? That's a kind of an interesting conversation. And we don't always have the opportunity to have those conversations in the abstract. So the idea that you would want to spend some time having that abstract conversation makes some sense to me. It beliefs is a kind of a loaded phrase. If we could take this out of the
kind of,
well, just like issues, if you want. It's like these are things that are, and I was sort of surprised at the list that you started talking about, because I wouldn't have necessarily called those beliefs. And I think that's what sort of where we may have gotten a little hung up here. But I think that the notion of the kinds of lists that you had is a really good one to have a conversation about.
Okay. So we'll do some work between now and then.
Just to be clear, so I'm going to cross off number 2, and I'm going to add evaluation of investment costs and minimize expenses. You're okay with having 3, 4, 5, and 6 on your list? We'll leave spots for blanks, and then you can vote. You'll have 7 points, and you can allocate it. We'll collect them at the June meeting. Staff will quickly tally it. We'll tell you what it is. But officially, the retirement board will approve it in July. Okay. So you have time.
Sounds good. All right. All right. Review of information requests. Lamont.
Sure. Let's see here. You have the committee would like John Stanton to provide updates on congressional and SEC policymaking regarding private equity. And I also noted during the asset allocation discussion that there's comment about the consultants isolating aspects of the portfolio construction that will have the most impact over the next 4 to 5 years. I think that was Mr. Unterman.
I love it.
Brought that up, but that's all.
Thank you. All right, so item 18 is a draft agenda for our June meeting. Take a look. So it sounds like Margo's got a, right? Oh, Chris?
No, I just wanted to highlight that you're touching right on it, which is June is, you did so well in the interviews for the retirement board. We've got to do a set of interviews on investments too. Your contract for private equity is up June 30. I would tell you, if you select a different firm, we'll have to do a small contract extension for PCA, but we kind of had to figure that anyway. Your schedule is so booked. This is the best time to get it in. We schedule those for 60 minutes each. We generally run it, tell the firms 20 minutes of presentation, leave you a good 30 minutes of Q&A, then 10 minutes, shuffle everybody in and out. We were going to do it differently than your legal interviews. We were going to wait for your deliberation at the very end. If you want to do it in between, we could set that up as a schedule. Just tell Sharon and she can let me know what you want to do. But yeah, I know you'll be thrilled to know it's going to be a long meeting.
Chris, you're looking, this is under our item 3?
No.
Or which? I'm
no,
sorry.
Turn the page, INV 322. 11.
Can you just tell me item number?
Item 11.
Okay,
11.
Thank you.
Item 11.
Okay, can we change it up a little bit for our finalists and just have it be, can they do like 10 to 15 minutes max in terms of their presentation? Given our style of interviewing, 10 okay. minutes is probably great,
it's your
if that's all right.
Yeah.
With probably a caveat that we might jump in even before that.
Okay.
So, but I would rather have it, is that all right with the rest of the committee? I just find that, as we have just demonstrated, some of our interactions with each other and being able to interact with the candidate, I think we get a better handle on, you know, we need the right fit for who we are as a board. And so I think if we could adjust that, so like 10 minutes presentation, what is that, 30, maybe 20 to whatever it takes, 20 to 30 minutes for the board to ask questions, and then what was the last, and then a confer time and then break. Did that work? I mean, I thought with our fiduciary, right? So we do, you know, 10 minutes of conferring with the board, and then we have a time for, you know, bathroom break, and then for the next one. Is that good? So that's 10, You got the numbers?
Yep.
Okay, perfect.
And my one request as your staff would be, I think I know the kind of questions you want them to prepare for, but if there are specific questions that you would like your private, because the private equity consultant works for you, if there are specific things you'd like them to be thinking about before they get here, email Sharon and she can send those to me and we'll make sure we include that in their packet so that they're the most prepared to come in and present to you.
Have a kind of a question like we had with for the fiduciary council. Are they going to have a question to prep that, ahead of time?
That's what we usually do,
okay.
But that's up to you. Again, these are your interviews, so however you want to do it.
My suggestion would be since Tom, so for the those of you who don't know, Tom Unterman and I are going to work with staff to kind of call the RFPs, and so if it's all right with the investment committee, perhaps Tom and I, and I'll consult with my vice chair, Paul. Could we just agree on a question to give to the, is that all right with you guys?
Well, yeah, sure.
Is that okay with everyone? I think obviously Tom, we've selected Tom since he's got a lot of expertise in this particular area. So, okay. And then we will have maybe, I know at times when we've done interviews, we've had sample questions for board members. I don't know if you would like that, some sample questions for you to ask, or
we'd be happy.
Well, it seems like we don't
them,
have a
but
problem.
Somehow, I don't think you need them, but we'll be prepared okay. to prepare them for you.
All right, great. Anything else for June?
Those were the key things I wanted to highlight. One other thing, we had to bump our sustainability speaker this meeting, which we mentioned why. In June, I want to highlight, we'll have, can I say his name? Yeah, we'll have Tom Steyer. So again, kind of a celebrity status. I'm sure the room will be packed. I think that's a time certain. We'll look it up, but that'll have to be a time certain. So we'll coordinate that with your closed session and your interviews because his schedule is pretty limited.
Thanks, Chris. Everyone good? Jack, we're gonna get to do a video and stuff, right, with him. We'll talk about that offline.
Yeah.
Okay. Great. Excellent. All right. Opportunities from statements from the public. Anyone from the public? All right.
We're going to do that by. He's not going to be here in person. We're going to do by video.
He's going to be here in person. No, okay. I'm sorry. What we've been trying to do, just this is public, right? What we've been trying to do with some of our high-profile speakers is not only do they present to the board, but Jack and the communication staff typically do a little video. So I don't know if you saw on the CalSTRS website, there's a video of Al Gore and David Blood. So
you,
we can show
no,
share with the public kind of who's coming to our board and so.
Just get the most mileage out of our presentation.
Right,
absolutely.
Right. So we can share it with folks who aren't actually even here at the board meeting. So with no opportunities for statements from the public, we will go into closed session. So for those of you who are leaving us, thanks for joining us for the last 3 days. Have a nice weekend.